this is joint work with Bai Chengyan and with Zhang Song from the Chinese University of Hong Kong. So what I'm going to argue is that if you think about the four, I'm going to say that the four key facts about China roughly since 2008, the four key facts are, you know, probably in order in which they're known, the slowdown in growth that, you know, some people call this the new normal. It's a great piece of marketing. You know, when something that doesn't turn out that well, you call it the new normal. The second thing, which is probably well known, it's been widely covered in the media, is the growing indebtedness of local governments and of some corporate firms. Okay, the two facts. The third fact, which is also pretty obvious if you look at the data, but it's probably not as well known, is that there's been a very large increase in the aggregate investment rate. So now, if you look at the data, China's investment rate stands at about 48-49% of GDP, which is probably the highest investment rate of any country in the world. Back in 2007-2008, it was about 40-41% of GDP. So just think about these facts. The investment rate has gone up about 8-9%, growth has slowed. The fourth fact, which some people have also noticed, typically in favorable terms, is that there's been a very sharp reversal of the current account surplus. Okay, China used to have, you know, 2008-2007, the current account surplus was 8-9% of GDP. Now it's about 2-3% of GDP. When people talk about this fact, they talk about, well, this is something that's good. It's one of the balancing that China needs to do. I must say that whenever people use the word balance, I typically run away as fast as I can because I don't quite know what the term means. And I'll be clear about this. What I'm gonna try to make the case is that you can understand all four facts, okay, as the consequence of what I'm gonna call the institutional changes that were brought about by China's fiscal stimulus. Okay. So just the bare bones fact is that in 2008, during, you know, when it looked like the world economy was going to hell, in October of 2008, China announced a very large fiscal stimulus program. So the headline numbers are that the fiscal stimulus was that the government was to spend 4 trillion yen, which is roughly about 11-12% of the GDP. Okay, so it's a mother of all stimulus plans. The money was to be spent in 2009 and 2010 into the mostly on public infrastructure projects. Okay, and then what I'm going to argue is that the details matter in how the fiscal stimulus was implemented, and the argument that I'm going to make is that the fiscal stimulus, it was not just the fiscal stimulus, but when you look at the details of how the fiscal stimulus was implemented, it led to a series of institutional changes that generated these four facts. Okay, so the baseline fact, so the bottom line, what I'm going to argue is that the way that you want to think about the fiscal stimulus, that it's not just the fiscal stimulus, that it really was the way you want to think about it, was it was partial financial liberalization. It was partial financial liberalization, and that led to these, and then once the fiscal stimulus stopped, when the program was over, the precise that this partial financial liberalization was very hard to undo. And in fact, it accelerated after the fiscal stimulus was over. So that's gonna be the bottom line. Before I make this argument, let me just take a minute to just take a step back to just provide a little bit more institutional context. Okay? And the context that I want to just get you to think about is you know, what was the world like in China in 2007 and 2008? And here I just want to make 2 points. So first, I want to just make 2 points about what local governments were doing and how and what local governments were doing. This is important because the fiscal stimulus was implemented by local governments. And the 2 points I just want to briefly mention, I can talk more about this, is that what you saw during this period, I think about this period of us, you know, roughly the early 1990s until 2007 and 2008, what you saw was that whenever you spend a little bit of time looking at what local governments do in in local governments do in China, what you see was that the entire bureaucratic apparatus, regardless of what their formal titles are, they're spending all their time basically facilitating deals by favored private firms. Okay, and we can talk about why is it that they do this. We can talk about the consequences of this activity and how you can make sense of the patterns of growth that you've seen coming out of China. But the point, the first point that I just wanted to make was that, you know, what you saw them doing was that, you know, the whole bureaucracy was basically operating almost like a private equity fund. Okay? But what was different was that it did so in a regime that was subject to severe financial constraints. And there were two main institutions that were responsible for these severe financial constraints. The first thing was the fiscal centralization in 1984, which basically removed the local government's control over financial resources. The second thing was the budget law. Which basically made it illegal for local governments to borrow. Okay? To borrow. And this is a way of, you know, one of the consequences of this is that when local governments are trying to make special deals and try to help their favorite private firms, one key resource they did not have access to was capital. Okay, so they did everything else that they could, but the key thing that they did not have was access to capital. Okay, I'll come back to this to this point. I'll come back to this when I talk about how the fiscal stimulus changed this changed what we see. 2008 came around, okay? And the plan and the decision at the level of central government was that they were gonna spend 12% of GDP. And that the program was to be implemented by local governments. But then you run into a problem, okay? How can you run a fiscal stimulus if it was illegal to borrow? I mean, that's sort of the basic question. If you can't borrow, how can you run a fiscal stimulus, right? There's, I mean, it just as a matter of accounting, you can't do it. You can't do it. So you can change the law. I mean, that's one way to square the circle. Another way to square the circle, which is the path that was taken, was to basically find a loophole in the law. And the loophole in the law was that basically, well, we need you to spend this money. You're not allowed to borrow. You're not allowed to borrow, so what we're gonna do is that we're gonna encourage you to borrow, but not through the formal channels. We're gonna encourage you to borrow off your balance sheet, okay? And so it doesn't show up on the formal books, so technically you're not breaking the budget law, okay? You're technically not breaking the budget law, and what are these things? These are the things that are now known as these local financing vehicles. These are basically these state-owned companies they're not really companies that do anything. I mean, do anything real in some sense. But they basically borrow money on behalf of local governments. And in the first few years, what they did is that they funded the fiscal stimulus. Okay. So there are two ways in which you can see this. Okay. One way to see this is if you just look at the details of the fiscal stimulus. So what we've done in the first column is that we've looked at the documents of the fiscal stimulus program, and we just listed the amount of spending that was planned under the fiscal stimulus. So you know we broke that up into seven or eight categories, and if you add up the first column, that's about 4 trillion yen. The second thing that we did is that then we look at the actual realized spending that shows up on the budget of the government. We looked at the same categories that was listed in the fiscal stimulus program. You add this up, that's in the second column, and that gives you the total spending by the central and the local government, which gives a total of 1 trillion yen, okay? So basically, there was roughly 1 trillion yen of the 4 trillion fiscal stimulus that shows up on the books of the government. And then the last column shows the spending by the local governments. And you can see that most of it was really spending by the local government. Okay? But it is still just 1/4. Okay, the fiscal stimulus. So if you look at the fiscal budget of the government, the spending was just 1/4 of what the actual plan was. Here's another way to see. Okay, if you look at the dotted line, the dotted red line, that's the budget deficit of the consolidated government, the central plus local governments, as a fraction of GDP. The vertical black lines denote the beginning and the end of the fiscal stimulus. And if all the fiscal stimulus program had showed up on the balance sheet of the government, what you should see is that in 2009 and 2008, the budget deficit should have increased by about 6 percentage points of GDP. You see a little bit of an increase of about 1% of GDP, which is consistent with what you see when you look at the actual the detailed spending categories. So one response that you could have was maybe the fiscal stimulus program was all just PR, that it never took place. But that, you know, when you look at other pieces of evidence, that doesn't seem to be right. One way to see this is if you look at the investment rate. And what you saw is that during the period of the fiscal stimulus, the investment rate went up by about 5 to 6% of GDP. Now, the reason it would show up in investment was because most of the projects were intended for infrastructure It's also not consistent with what you see with your eyes, with about what I remember seeing with my eyes in China during this time period. So what I want to argue is that the gap between these two lines represents the off-balance sheet spending by local governments that were financed by the creation of these local financing vehicles. So I'll next show you just the magnitude of this. But before I do that, I just want to make one point clear. The fiscal stimulus program ended in 2010, okay? And if that was all there was to it, the investment rate should have gone down, okay? But what you can see from this is that it stayed up. So the second point that I want to argue is that the institutions that were created by how the fiscal stimulus was financed continued, and not just continued, but they continued to grow. And I'll show you some pieces of evidence that that these institutions have really changed the way in which the Chinese regime works. Okay, so let me get to the data. So this is something that's been somewhat covered by the media, but the question is, okay, what's the magnitude of this off-balance sheet spending? Okay, and there are two sources of data that you can use on these companies called local financing vehicles. The two sources of data is that there's a company called Wind. Okay. Think of it roughly like the Bloomberg of China, and they collect data from the financial statements of local financing vehicles that issue bonds. I'll show you in a minute that these local financing vehicles that issue bonds that show up in this data is just a small subset of all the local financing vehicles, because most local financing vehicles do not issue bonds. Okay, but what is nice about this data is that you have individual data on these local financing vehicles, and you can observe their total debt. Okay, the second source of data, which is the data that's been most frequently reported in the media, I'm going to call this the official data, is that there were two audits that were publicly released by the government. Okay, there was an audit done in 2011. There was an audit done in 2013, and it's an audit of all the local financing vehicles. Okay, the last publicly released data was in 2013. But you can see, but there have been a number of public statements made by senior Chinese officials that are based on more recent versions of this data, although they have not released publicly more recent versions of the data. So the advantage of the official data is that it includes all the local financing vehicles, not just the ones that issue bonds. The limitation is, this is important to keep, is important to keep in mind, is that the data, the official debt, it only covers what I'm going to call the official debt of the local financing vehicle. And there's an important difference between the official debt and the data that is covered by WIND. Okay? The definition of official debt is that it's debt that government has a responsibility to repay, or debt the government will fulfill the responsibility of guarantee when the debtor encounters difficulties in repayment. Okay? To understand the difference between these two, let me just talk about one of these companies. And we picked this company because we know this company somewhat well. We know this company somewhat well, and just it illustrates what these local financing vehicles are now. Okay? And I picked this because, so here's a picture that you probably are seeing. I have seen. This is a picture of two sports facilities in Beijing that were built for the Beijing Olympic. I think the Chinese call it the Aquatic Cube and the Bird's Nest. I don't know what the official names are. I'm sure that's not the official name. These two facilities are owned by a company called the Beijing Asset Management Group. Okay? So this was the local financing vehicle created by the Beijing local government to fund all the sports facilities. Okay? And these are, as you can imagine, these are money-losing ventures, okay? The numbers that I've heard is that the Bird's Nest loses 100 million yen every year. They're money-losing, the total debt, but these institutions have evolved, okay? They're no longer just public infrastructure companies. So I'll just talk a little bit about this company. The total debt of BSAM, as reported in the WIND data, is about 70 billion yen. That's about roughly $10 billion. It's actually a local financing vehicle that's below the average size in terms of debt. When you look at what else they do, again, the reason we know this is because my co-author is on the board. It's on the board of this company. And they also own several financial companies. They own companies that are in real estate, and they own a bunch of manufacturing companies. So just to give you some example of companies that you may know, it's a large shareholder of the Bank of Beijing. It's a large shareholder of the Beijing Auto Group. Okay. If you ever wonder why when you go to Beijing the only taxis are Hyundais, I don't know. I'm sure you guys have noticed that the only taxis you're gonna find are Hyundais. The reason they're all Hyundai is because the Hyundai joint venture is owned by the Beijing Auto Group. And if you go to Shanghai, you're not gonna see the Hyundais. It's gonna be somebody else. So. When you think about this company, okay, what is the official debt? The official debt is just going to be the debt that was acquired to finance the Aquatic Cube and the Bird's Nest. That was the debt that was taken on by this local financing vehicle for official public purposes. Everything else, okay, according to the Ministry of Finance, is not official debt. Okay? It's something else. It's something else. The advantage of the WIND data is that it covers all the debt. It covers both the official debt and the debt that was used for the Bank of Beijing, for the Beijing Auto Group, for all the real estate companies, for all the financial companies. Now, you know, it depends on the question you want to ask. It depends, for some question you may only want to know the numbers for the official debt. If the question is, how has the influence of local governments over the allocation of capital change, then you may want to know the total debt, the total debt. So I'll show you some of the difference between these two sources of data. So first, just the number of local financing vehicles. The red line is the number of local financing vehicles as reported in the WIND data. Okay, so this is the subset of local financing vehicles that issue bonds. It goes up, you know, after the financial crisis, and it's ending, and the rough number to have in your head is that there's about 1,700 bond-issuing local financing vehicles in China. The official data, which covers all the local financing vehicles, that's what I call those are the two dots, that's the NAO, the number there is about 7,000. So there's about 7,000, the number of total local financing vehicles is about 7,000. Okay, so the WIN data is only a subset of that. Now this is the data on the total debt. Okay, so the black line is the official data on the total amount of debt, total amount of official debt of all the local financing vehicles. So the now you can see the total debt goes up, and then the number by 2015, it's about 23 trillion yen. Okay, that's the rough number. If you look at the WIN data, which is just the subset, it's about, you know, 1/5 of the sample. Okay, the total debt in the WIN data is this blue line, and the total debt there of this subset of this, the raised, a much smaller subset, is about 36 trillion yen. Okay, so the smaller number has a large, much larger debt, and the companies that are in the blue line is a subset of the company. And the difference is that one just covers the official debt, and the other one covers all the debt. So what you want to know is, well, what is the total amount of debt? Nobody really knows. So what we do in order to get that number is that when you look at the underlying micro data in WIN, the distribution of total debt looks roughly like a Pareto distribution, like lots of phenomena in the world. So if we make the assumption that the debt in the WIN data is a truncated sample of the full version of the data, the beauty about assuming Pareto is that the parameters of a truncated Pareto is the same as the parameters of the full Pareto. We estimate the parameters of the Pareto I will be like Gandhi. So if we make that assumption, we get the red line, which is our estimate of the total. Our estimate of the total amount of debt, which is about 45. Forty-five trillion yen. So when you look at this, this is just the same data, but in the same data in flows. There's been some discussion in the media about how there's been a crackdown on what these local financing vehicles are doing, which is true if you look at the official debt. That's the black line. But if you look at the red line, you can see that number has even gone up. And the way that you want to think about the difference between the red line and the black line is that it represents what I'm going to call the commercial activities of these local financing vehicles. So another way of thinking about this is that these local financing vehicles, most of them no longer are these infrastructure supporting companies. Maybe the closest analogy that that I can think of is that they almost operate like private equity funds. Okay, but private equity funds that are with a twist, right? They're private equity funds under the control of the local organization department with, you know, all the other constraints that, well, under the control of the organization department, and possibly with weak budget, with soft budget constraints. Okay, so let me just say then, what are the consequences of this? I'll just say this. Okay, the media run effects is that there's been what looks like a permanent increase in the investment rate. There's a decline in the current account surplus. And basically, what we're saying is that both of these are just the consequences of the same thing. There are many people who, like, you know, there's this really funny speech that was given by David Lipton, who said, you know, the reversal in the current account balance is a wonderful thing in China, but look at this growing indebtedness of China, and that's a problem. You know, that I can't make sense of that, because I don't see how you can praise one thing and condemn the other thing, because if both of them are outcomes of exactly the same thing, that logic just makes sense. The long run effects is the potential for a debt crisis. We don't know. That has a reduced private investment so far? No, in the aggregate. What I'm gonna say is that it's not really about the aggregate that you should care about, but about what it's done to the allocation of capital among different types of private in different private investment. And the broader question is, it's what it's done is that it's removed the financial constraints over Chinese local governments that made the, what I'm going to call the special deal regime in China work in the way that it did for 20 years. Okay, so I'll end there. Thanks.
Discussant is the Professor Yi Huang of the graduate school in Geneva.
Go ahead. So thank you very much for Professor Wei Chung inviting me. Thank you for not to introduce me.
You don't have
I don't have
it.
I listen.
Here, okay. You just need to turn it on.
Which one you want?
Either.
Okay. So it's my great honor to discuss this very rich paper and ask someone to do the similar exercise. I really appreciate and really understand how tremendous work Professor Chang-Tai Hsieh and his team did it. You have to go through all the balance sheet of that contract. And it took me 2 years to do the similar work. But since I'm doing use a similar approach, I try to, today my job is try to provide some evidence for some questions, I found some papers. It was very rich papers. So I tried to provide some evidence, some comments, and I'm looking forward to follow-up questions. So first question, I think, is motivations. So this paper is very, very important for China. This paper is very, very important for China. So talk about low government debt, slow down growth in China, talk about financial market liberalization, even talk about current account. As I mentioned, I don't have enough time to go through every detail. I just mentioned the data work. It's tremendous, it's really hard, comprehensive, very consistent with the National Audit Office so in terms of training, but you know, they have different kind of leeway in terms of data. Secondly, I think very important to talk about how to link to the literature. People talk about financing, people talk about political economy of financing, especially Professor Sumit. So basically it's very important about China, two phenomena. Number one, we have a very segmented financial market, okay? Every lending, local firm finance locally. Second, very important is about special deals. Those kind of credit mislocation across different kind of firms. In these papers, talk about connected firm and non-connected firms. So which will lead to long-term effect in terms of if a capital, if you believe the story grows like China, if capital reallocated from high productivity sectors to low productivity sectors, so it might lead to long-term growth decline. So this paper is extremely, it is very, very important. So I will highlight, you know, I will highly encourage everybody read it more carefully. So since I'm about enough time, so I just quick go through the literature. So I try to put everyone in the program in the literature, so you can see all the friends, all the people in the literature. First, they talk about fiscal spending, talk about debt, growth of debt, which lead to who? Nobody knows. So we need micro data to identify the shocks. Secondly, very important, I talk about fiscal spending and carbon out or carbon in effect. So this is the key for the long-term impact. I want to highlight three channels. Number one channel, through my former boss, Olivier, it has public debt crowding out private investment, usually comes through interesting channels. Think about it. China, as a Europe, like optimal currency area, every state, every city is face same interest rate designed by central bank China, number one. Number two, the rising literature of political connections and the public debt, private investment. I will highlight Lauren Kaufman's paper and also this paper, Chong Bai's paper and Chang Lexia Michael Sung's paper. Finally, I want to serve, you know, advertising my paper with Marco Pagano, Ugo Panisa, and also with William Chong and his co-author paper. We try to see, look, so it might have some due to this kind of a very special, you know, segmentation, financial market, interest rate saving, so it might have something called credit rational channels. Okay, so this is the literature. And there's also very grossing, you know, very important literature in terms of misallocation, frictions. I even put the numbers, new paper there. And also Chinese government debt and the financial market. So if I miss any literature, please let me know. Okay. Okay, I don't have enough time to talk about go through the very beautiful models, talk about financial liberalization, what's the impact of financial liberalization between connected and unconnected firms. But I want to highlight the result. So it might have a clouding out effect. They might have an increasing borrowing cost due to this kind of fiscal spending. They might have reduced the fund flows and the trade surplus. And finally, they might rise It's like market interest rate. So which is similar, like there's a paper, Michael and the King did it, okay? Let me show some data to prove the argument is right, okay? Number one, I have a one paper, I will try to see the borrowing cost across the times. In the top, a Chinese policy rate, maturity is 5 years, regulated. The bottom, the US interest rate, okay? You can see the chunk increase after 2008, even the policy rate. Also, the red line to red line are the bond yields, 5 years. It sees also rising. Okay, so compares policy rate in China and the international market. However, people talk about, look, China have capital controls. How about domestic interest rate, shadow rate, okay? We also capture the shadow rate market interest rate, okay? Look, Matthew, I start from 10% annual terms. Up 2008, increased dramatically, okay? Then overall, the trends go up and up and up until we see what happens now. Okay, so this is some evidence I try to identify, you know, what's his argument in the papers. And the main suggestion is how to identify it, because we should know who's connected, who's not connected. So usually people combine Chinese company to SOE and the private firms. However, in this concept, because I remember I cite few paper, in the paper, said, in that paper, try to argue the connected firm are largest or listed firms. Okay, to make less finance constraint. Secondly, very important, I think, I would like to provide one more piece of suggestions in the follow-up question. It's follow-up JF paper by Ruhong and my paper with Marcos. We try to think about it. How government spending, do we have sort of exposure index? We sort from micro data every kind of usage for the government spending. Okay, then we match with input-output tables. Then we calculate this kind of exposure to government spending index, which might be good. That's first stage to do interaction terms. Consider I only have 2 minutes. I have enough slides. I will leave everything back. I have 2 minute comments. Okay, one last thing in terms of distortions. We also try to see the red line increase dramatically, SOEs after 2008, the leverage, okay? Firm level evidence on average. Then this is going down to private sectors, piece of evidence as well. So finally, I don't have enough time, but you know, if I think at the end of the day, our slides will be online.
Yes, they will be.
And I want to highlight one thing. It's 1 minute.
No,
2 minutes. So since I'm really like this paper, I try very hard to understand the paper. Also, I try to provide new evidence. So we talk about domestic currency, okay? RMB borrowing. However, those animal, low government investment vehicle, it's issued borrowed in dollar terms. So I calculate from deal logic, I calculate all the offshore, okay, bond issuer, okay, I calculate outstanding. In the top red bar are foreign currency. If you sold foreign currency, majority are dollar, okay? Majority, the local government, non-tradable sector, risky sector, overcapacity sectors, they borrow dollar. Remember, in 2009, beautifully built up positions, foreign currency exposures, no hedgings. Since RMB is going to depreciate, you know, dollar going up, so highly exposure to foreign currency, so called mismatch problems. Finally, so also when they borrow money last minute, once they borrow, what's they doing? We run a lot of regression. We didn't see anything related to. We see this counting out. What happened to SOEs? Most of the SOE connected firms, they do one very interesting business, so called interfirm loans. We even calculate the interfirm loans after they borrow money internationally in dollar terms, and they look at the preventions, the declining, which means they do a lot of risky financial mediation once they borrow money abroad, okay? Finally, let me conclude, very polished paper with a lot of neat ideas, and I know a lot of work in terms of collect data, and also I provide some practical suggestions, and I'm looking forward to the follow-up questions. Thank you. Merci beaucoup.
For questions. I feel the need to defend my former colleague David Lipton. Professor Hsieh, the picture that you drew about what happened to capital markets and the allocation of credit in China is, I think, very consistent with David's view and my view that we had an unsustainable situation with the huge
Japanese current account, and I think the testimony of that is even though it's receded, it fed into the political process in the U.S. and helped to generate the electoral outcome we had last fall. And it had long been seen that a more sustainable path was one where China depended more on domestic demand, something that's an issue that the IMF deals with many countries. And domestic demand could be consumption, or it could be investment. And he was observing that it was so intensively investment that that's probably not sustainable either. And I think what you talk about in terms of the explosion of debt that was being created kind of reinforces that concern. But I'm wondering whether you think the process that you described is something that can continue with debt creation, the allocation of investment, which is obviously producing very low returns because GDP has slowed, is something that can continue, or whether there has to be another kind of what I would call, you would call something else, rebalancing to sustain the Chinese economy.
We'll take more questions.
This is a question for Professor Hsieh. You mentioned the stimulus package. And then later on, you said that the local government had to borrow money. I thought the package means that the local government received money. They don't need to borrow. They still need to borrow. So what does the stimulus package mean? The central government wants to spend a lot of money. It's not giving the money away?
No.
I see. Okay. So that the order is that for the local government, we want to spend the money, but you find the money. Mm-hmm. Okay, good. Because I teach a course on the Chinese economy. I think I better know that. I didn't know that. I thought they have the money. Yeah. Oh, but I don't want to go on. But
they have the money, they just don't want to spend it.
Yeah, but I...
That's what you'd normally call quasi-fiscal system.
Yeah. They I think they have.
So actually, I have two related questions. The first one is, we know the local government financing vehicles are mostly concentrated on construction, infrastructure, and utilities. So for the four motivating facts at the beginning of the presentation, do they apply to sectors outside this domain? And I would guess yes, because as you said, you know, after the stimulus, maybe they start to invest in other sectors. But at the same time, during the stimulus expansion, in addition to the fiscal spending part, there's also just a general credit expansion that could have also led to this effect. And my second question is on whether we mentioned the local financing vehicles are not real companies. So I just want to understand that a little bit better. So when are they holding companies of subsidiaries that are real companies, or they are just contracting with real companies to complete these construction projects?
John wants to say something.
Another big channel of this is land, right?
The land?
Land has played the critically important roles for local financing vehicles.
That's their collateral.
Right, use a collateral. But they actually play, so there's an investment banker, the researcher from investment banker found that some of the land,
the local
government sell the land. Local finance vehicles buy the land, and they use the land as collateral to borrow money from the banks. So that created lots of risk if the whole housing market is in trouble. So that has, I think, it will be quite interesting to follow up. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so let me tackle some of the questions. So about Will's question, I would say two things. One is about the nature of local financing vehicles. It is true when you look at the local financing vehicles that the origin was in the sectors that you mentioned. Like the one that I highlighted. It was created, and for the first. So the first years of the origin company, all it did were sports facilities. When you look at, and that was the intention of that. That was the original intention.
when you look at them now, okay, the sectors that you're describing is only just a small fraction of what they do. It's only a small fraction. So they're called local financing vehicle because that's how they got their mandate. But the company that I mentioned, our rough guess is that something like 95% of the assets of the company are in non-infrastructure stuff, are non-infra. And the way that you want to think about it is that you want to go back and think about the political forces that are behind this. So you have these local governments that with high-powered incentives, with a very well-established apparatus for basically creating support for favored private firms. It's not really state-owned firms. It's really, I mean, I think that is sometimes. Some people think a lot about state government. That's really not where the action is. The action is in these large, profitable, and influential private firms and basically what the fiscal stimulus did is that it created this vehicle. I hate to use that term twice, right? But it really is a vehicle for which, you know, now they have a powerful new tool that they can do what they've been doing, but in a much more effective way from their point of view. That they now have money to. They now have money to use. So then, when the fiscal stimulus ended and the orders came down, banks are no longer to lend to the local financing vehicles, you can imagine the reaction of local governments. Like, no, wait. You know, we like this 10% of GDP. We like to have access to money. So, Sigel has a paper on then how the financial market changed in response to both things: the crackdown by the central government and the incentives of local governments that they really want. This is what led his argument is that this is what led rise to the shadow banking and these other things. So the point is that when you ask the second question, you ask is, well, what are these companies now? You know, maybe you want to think about Berkshire Hathaway. I mean, that's a way to think about it. You know, is Berkshire Hathaway a real company or a fake company? It does something, right? It does something. It doesn't produce anything. It doesn't produce anything. But what does it do? It allocates capital, right? It allocates capital. It maybe infuses some management talent, or, you know. So think about Berkshire Hathaway. Think about the Cerberus Group. That's sort of what these local financing vehicles are like now. Okay, but with the key difference that they're still under the control of the local organization department. And possibly with weak budget constraints. So this goes to the question that Gan mentioned, that when some of these companies start to lose money, who's going to pay the bill? And that is still not known. That is still unknown. The question is, what is China going to do in the future? I think the science, at least my reading of the evidence is that it doesn't. So there have been several attempts by the central government to crack down on this behavior. The first one was after 2010, and then Zhiguo has a paper that talks about the reaction. There was another crackdown in 2014. Another crackdown when they try to bring some of this off-balance sheet debt and they try to formalize it by allowing the governments to convert this debt into official bonds, into official local governments. That lasted for all of 6 months. I mean, that lasted for all of 6 months because what you saw after 6 months was that there was a very sharp reverse. So all the evidence I have is that they are likely going to continue to go back to what they were doing. And I'll just restate, you know, what I said about, I didn't mean to criticize Lipton. I just meant to say that people don't think clearly enough about about the links between the outcomes that they're talking about.